Thank you, Kelly. So I think my role here tonight is to provide you with a brief overview of what microboards are. I'm not going to get into too many of the nuts and bolts, just given our timing constraints and because there are a lot of people who've been involved in the microboard movement who know a whole lot more than I do and have been doing this for a long time. But generally speaking, a microboard, or some of you may have heard them referred to as, or similar corporations referred to as SODAs or self-directed support organizations. These are small not-for-profit corporations that are formed with the primary purpose of providing support to one individual. So within the context of this project, each individual, each family involved in HTF incorporated a microboard. So family members came together with the person supported, in some cases some trusted friends and other people in the community who had a strong relationship or a strong connection with the individual to form this microboard. So essentially what we did was incorporate a not-for-profit corporation, which I'll talk a little bit more about in just a second. Composed or comprised of a board of directors, family members and trusted friends that had a personal relationship with this one person who were committed to providing ongoing sort of oversight and support in relation to, primarily in relation to, I think, the housing model that had been developed. But they signed on to provide support in other areas as well, such as supporting the person with making decisions related to their health care or their finances or their ODSP supports or their RDSP investments. So the idea here is that the board committed to sort of carving out some time, either once a month or once a quarter, to get together and oversee sort of all aspects of the individual's life. Like I said, there are a few different variations of these corporations. The microboard movement was really born out west, and an organization, a wonderful organization by the name of Vela, that's based out in BC, really does champion the whole microboard initiative, and I'd encourage you to have a look at their website, vela.org. In Ontario, we've also had, as I mentioned, similar movements that started, I believe, about 20 years ago. Corporations called Rojas, and then there are other families or other people that just have come to us over the years that have said, we want to incorporate, and the reason for incorporating sometimes varies, but we want a corporation, we want to bring people together, we want to formalize this support network or circle of support that has been in place to provide support to a person over the course of their life. They wanted to formalize that in order to ensure that the people involved are committed, and in order to build in what I think is one of the primary reasons we incorporated microboard, we wanted to build in some succession planning and some sustainability in the individual's life. So that's at a very high level what microboards are. Why would you incorporate it? You'd incorporate, as I said, to kind of formalize the network, to build on that, build in some commitment. Often people will incorporate or start thinking about incorporating, not that this is necessarily a precursor, but when there are some individualized funding dollars at play. So if we look at the models here tonight, as I said, each family's got a microboard in place. And I think Kim may talk a little bit more to this, but let's say the funds originate from the ministry, they flow to the broker, which is YSSN in this case, and then from YSSN to the microboard. So the microboard is, instead of funds, many people who are exposed to or have passport funding in place, often money's flowing from broker to, let's say, parent or sibling, and it's the parent or the sibling that's administering the funding, which, depending on the level of funding, may be fine for a certain period of time, but when we're dealing with individualized funds, especially when we're talking about funds that are, I mean, most of the dollars flowing in these models are higher than what people would typically receive through a password allocation. So we want to make sure that there are inherent checks and balances built in, that there's accountability built in, that there's transparency built in, and that the administration of those funds outlive parents and outlive family members. Hence the idea of bringing people together to sort of share that responsibility of providing support to the individuals. So succession planning and sustainability, I think, is huge. The other piece here is that with most of these models, funds are being used, or a portion of the funds are being used, to pay workers. So either employing employees or contracting with independent contractors. Most of you, I assume, being parents, are aware of all of the challenges that come along with employing people or contracting with workers, and the added liability, that exposure to liability, exposure to risk that comes along with that. So establishing a microboard helps to mitigate a bit of that risk. It forces the corporations to take protective measures and safeguards, such as implementing the right kind of insurance coverages, putting those sorts of things in place, whether it be WSIB coverage for workers, or directors and officers coverage for the board, or just general liability coverage, making sure that workers are insured by independent contractors, making sure that they've got the right kind of coverages in place. If there's a vehicle in use, making sure that the proper coverage is in place for vehicles. And so we've seen microboards really promote and encourage the implementation of these safeguards. Kelly also wanted me to talk a little bit about some of the considerations, or some of the sort of the cons, or some of the, I wouldn't call them surprises, but maybe added challenges that came up as we were working through starting up these corporations. A big one was cost. So I think initially we had maybe, or the boards had sort of under budgeted what was going to be required in terms of annual or ongoing maintenance and compliance costs. I'd say specifically related, don't always have to blame the lawyers, but it's some legal costs, some accounting costs, insurance costs that are associated as well. From a legal standpoint, I can say that, you know, there are quite a few legal considerations that have to be thought through. There's corporate law involved, there's not-for-profit governance law involved, there is tax law, employment law, depending on what your model looks like. We get into landlord and tenancy issues or considerations, municipal law often. So there are all of these different aspects that need to be addressed and considered depending on what your model looks like. And so, you know, having a line item in your budget for ongoing legal is important. Also, depending on how much money is flowing to the microboard, that will sort of influence your financial reporting requirements and your audit requirements to Corporations Canada, or to the Ministry of to the provincial ministry, depending on if you incorporate provincially or federally. And so you've got to build in costs for review engagements or for audits as well. What we've really tried to do within this project is figure out ways, develop relationships with lawyers and accountants and bookkeepers and payroll companies that we can, you know, we can go to these, we can access professional services, knowing that there are 8 families or 10 families, or, you know, how many, knowing that there's a group of families who are interested in procuring services, that has helped bring down the costs in some of these areas. The other sort of consideration that is very prominent is identifying people to serve on the microboard. And I think this starts very early in life for all sorts of reasons, and sort of in the sense of, you know, identifying trustees for your estates and your wills, and identifying people to act on a personal support network. But when it comes to identifying directors for a microboard, it's a different level of responsibility, because these people now have fiduciary obligations to a corporation. And so it can often be a bit of a harder sell, depending on whether or not people want to take on that exposure to risk, and whether or not they have the time to actually commit to the microboard. And I'm sure maybe some of the families here tonight can speak to that.